When graphing a polynomial that has been factorised, what does it mean if one of the factors is repeated, or even if more than one factor is repeated? That's what I want to explain in this video, where I discuss the third variation on my theme of how to use the roots of polynomials in order to graph them. Let's choose as an example y equals x minus 2 squared times x plus 1. You can see that I could have written this as x minus 2 times x minus 2 times x plus 1, but this is the abbreviated form using the square. Now, what effect does this square have on the graph? Because it has no effect on the root. When we set y equal to 0, we still only get a root at 2, and we get a root at minus 1. They're the only numbers that make this expression 0. Why the square? Well, this root occurs twice, because this factor occurs twice. We call it a double root. And what effect does that have on the graph? Let me explain. We first need to understand that every graph that is of the form x squared, or x to the 4, or x to the 6, or x to the 8, what we call even functions, looks like a parabola. It is symmetrical about the y-axis, and as the power increases, the graph gets steeper and steeper. We also need to understand that if we have y equals x, that is x to the power 1, or x cubed, or x to the 5th, or x to the 7th. We have what are called odd functions. And these graphs come down to zero and they level off instantaneously. And they look like an S shape. And in fact, if you look at them upside down, if you could stand on your head or turn the monitor upside down, you would see it would be the same shape when rotated 180 degrees. It turns out that every factor that has an even power behaves like this near the root, and every factor that has an odd power, like this has got a power of 1, behaves a bit like this near the root. The principle to understand here is that when we're examining the behaviour of a polynomial near one of its roots, the factor containing that root is dominant. If, for example, we were studying values near 2, that is, near the double root of 2, this term is extraordinarily close to 0. And if I alter the x value by a tiny margin, x minus 2 could be as small as a thousandth or a millionth. When I square it, that becomes even smaller still. And a slight adjustment in that value can make a huge percentage difference to this term. Whereas, if I'm near 2, this term remains very, very close to 3. Whether I make it 3 plus 1 millionth or 3 plus a thousandth, is not going to make a big difference to this term, but it makes a massive difference to this one. Also, if I move to this factor here, when x is near the root minus 1, this dominates. Because if I put minus 1 into here, I get minus 1 minus 2 is minus 3, and square it and get 9. And a small variation from minus 1 to minus 1.01, for example, will not make a big difference. It'll be a number very, very close to 9, but it will make a huge difference to this term, to this factor. So the principle is that when you're near a root, the factor containing the root is dominant. And that means that this will behave like an even-powered function, whereas here this will behave like an odd-powered function. And if I was to graph it, I'll just show you this very, very quickly. I would still draw my axes, identify the two roots, 1, 2. If you're doing this in pencil, it's sometimes nice just to write a little 2 there to remind you that it's a double root. There's another root at minus 1. And my graph goes through those two points, even though it's a cubic. I have an x cubed times x, and I expect it to be an S shape. The leading coefficient is positive. That is, it's got a plus x and a plus x. So I know the graph goes up here. But as it tries to go through this root at 2, because this is dominating and it's behaving like a square, very close to this, it behaves like a parabola and bends and bounces off. It's almost as though, because that root there is there twice, it tries to go through it once and then through it again and never quite makes it through. And then, of course, the graph must go through the other root. So this is the slight variation on the theme that I wanted to show you. Let's try it on a slightly more complicated polynomial. I'm just going to make one up now. Let's have an x minus 1, an x plus 4, an x minus 5, an x, and an x plus 2. I'm keeping my factors very simple. And let's have a double here and a triple and another double. Well, let's make this 4, just to be a little excessive. Now this is way more difficult than anything you're going to graph at school, or possibly even at university, by the way of polynomials. But it's an x squared times x cubed times x times x cubed times x to the fourth, which means if I expand it, that I'm going to have 4, 7, 8, 11, 13, an x to the power 13 graph. But let's look at how simple it is to graph using these skills. I'm not going to write, because I need room for the graph, I'm not going to write the roots out. We'll just work them out as we go. We have a root at 1, and it's going to be a double root, so I'll write a small 2 there. We have a root at negative 4, and it's a triple root, so I'll write a little 3, just to remind me. I have a root at plus 5, and it's a normal single root. I have a root at 0, and it is a triple. These are going to be a bit close together. Now I have a root at minus 2, and it's a fourth powered root. It's there 4 times. Now, the leading coefficient is positive. All the x's are positive. So I know that my graph goes up to the right. It comes down through 5, because 5 is, in fact, it was the only normal root we have. When it tries to come up through 1, being a double root, it behaves like a parabola. And it bounces down. It tries to come up through 0, but being a triple root, it has that little S shape of a cubic equation. It tries to come down through minus 2, but being an even powered root, it bounces off like a parabola. Then it wants to come down through the next root, and being a triple root, it behaves like that odd function again, and it's got a little bend in it. And there we go. Now, of course, we need to use calculus to find these maxima and minima and points of inflection, but the roots help us get a general picture of the shape of the polynomial very, very quickly. That's a complicated version. We'll do it one more time with a simpler cubic. Now, I'm going to write the cubic equation up, but I'm going to add a slight twist to it, as you'll see. Can you see what I've done? Not only do I have a double root, but this term is reversed. Notice the leading coefficient of x is negative. So if I rearrange this equation a little, I get the following. Because minus x gives me minus x, and minus minus 4 gives me plus 4. So here you can see that I actually have a negative leading coefficient for the x cubed, and I have two roots. I can find them by setting y equal to 0. So x is negative 2 and x is 4. They're the two possible roots. And to graph them, we have one root at negative 2. It is a double root, so I put a little 2 above it. I have another root at 4. It is a normal root, but the minus sign means that my graph starts on the right-hand side by going down. It comes up through the normal root at 4, wants to come down through the root at 2, at minus 2, but being a double root, it behaves like a parabola. And there is the shape of that particular cubic equation. Now I'm going to create some worksheets for the original factored polynomials that I described about 3 videos ago, and other worksheets for the 3 different variations that I've described to you in the last 2 videos and this one. Those worksheets will be posted on my website and will be downloadable from the links shown in the description below this video in a few days' time. In the meantime, I hope this has helped you understand the principles behind using the roots of polynomial equations to graph them, at least to get the general shape of them. Thank you for watching.